thank you for the invitation for being here. Thank all my colleagues that have helped me kind of understand the climate system over the last, whatever, I've been in this field 30 years or so maybe now. And I'm going to try to, I have so much to tell you guys, but I'll try to spend my time. And it's something that really gets you stuck, and you think it's really important, please ask a question. I mean, I do have a lot of time to get through, but if there's something to say, like, if I don't understand this, the next 10 slides are going to be a waste of time, please ask, okay? All right. So, recognize that picture? I stole it from your website. Let's see. I love that picture. So, okay, here's the outline. We're just a couple slides about what the present day climate is at the West, and every once in a while I'm going to come back to Bozeman. Then we'll talk about the climate variability we've seen in the last 100 years in the West, in the U.S. Talk a little bit about deeper time, just so we can put it in perspective of where we're going in the future. Okay? All right. So, present-day climate in the Western United States. We'll use Bozeman as an example. The Bozeman is kind of an example of summer dry or summer wet. So Bozeman is kind of like in the summer wet. It's like on the edge of summer wet, right? There's more rainfall average May through September here than there is in October. More precipitation September through March, right, or April. The role of Rockies is a really big player in this, okay? So that's good, right? Here's the climatology. Let's see, if you tune in for once. Just look at the last 100 years of data. The average January temperature is around 20 degrees Fahrenheit, and the average June and July temperature is around 65, average day and night. And here's precipitation, so it's maximum in May and June, and you have a little dip here, and that comes up again in the fall, and it's a minimum in the winter. Okay, average annual temperature, 43 degrees Fahrenheit, 18 and a half inches of rain. Okay. That's not my data. None of this is my data. Here's a picture of the climatological precipitation in the United States and Canada. And red here is over 200 centimeters, or 2 meters of rainfall in these coastal rains. There are places that get more than 5 meters of rain, like in the Olympic Mountains of Washington. And then there's about a meter and a half of rainfall down here. And then there's this big gap here where there's very little rainfall. B is buoyancy, B on the plot, supposedly. So B is frozen, it's about right there. And the white contours here are contours of elevation. The first one is a 500 meter contour, then 1,000, and then 2,000 meter contour. So basically, where you have high elevation, you have less rainfall, right? And on the western side of those mountains, where the wind is coming in, the mountains basically milks, you know, basically distills all the water vapor out of the atmosphere, deposits there, leaving very little vapor to actually make it across the Rockies. Okay. If you look at this, the ratio of summer versus winter rainfall, west of the crest of the Rockies here, you see all these like dark blues, which means very little of the rainfall, there's very little rainfall in summer compared to winter. And if you go just to the east of the crest of the Rockies, it's red here, which means there's three times more rainfall in summer than there is in winter. So the Rockies really kind of cut up the continent into winter wet, summer wet. Good? No surprises there. Okay. So what would life be like without the Rocky Mountains? As a climate scientist, I get to play God. And I can go into my climate model and just remove the Rockies. Not just the Rockies, but the Sierra and the Cascades and all the other things that make life worth living. Okay. When you do that, you take the Rockies out and you say, how does the climate change? And the answer is, well, I don't know if you can read these things. These are in Celsius now, and this is actually up to 15 degrees Celsius warmer. And part of this is just simply because you go high up, you go over the crest of the Rockies, you're way high up in the atmosphere, and as you go up in the atmosphere, temperature drops, right? So it's part of this just that we're coming down in the atmosphere, so it's warming. That's not all of it. There's no mountains there in northeast Canada, and that's a warming of 5 degrees. There's actually large global variations of removing the Rockies, not just over where we live. There's both of them. So without the Rockies, the western U.S. would be up to 15 degrees Celsius warmer on average, annual average. Okay? And precipitation, not surprising from what I just showed you, if I take out the Rockies, precipitation along the West Coast here drops by 30 to 40%. And precipitation over here, east of where the Rockies were, right, goes up by almost twice, by 100%. We're in Bozeman, it's about 40 to 50%, the precipitation would go up. Okay, so it's a really big deal. But also, it turns out the Rockies do really interesting things, like they control the storm track. So this is where the storm track is in over the Atlantic. There's lots of things that happen when you take out the Rockies. Okay, now, here's a picture of that same plot of the annual cycle in temperature in Bozeman today, and the annual cycle in temperature if you take out the Rockies. Right, just think about a winter that's 36 degrees on average here in Bozeman instead of 20 in January. In the summer, that's on average, the day and nighttime average temperature is 80 degrees. Right? It's a pretty different world. Right? If you think about precipitation, here's the same precipitation today, the May-June peak. Right? And if you take out the Rockies, you get that. Not only do you get way more rainfall, but it's all winter rainfall and little summer rainfall. Right? So the Rockies have a really big control. And Bozeman is just one example. I mean, this is true in Denver and everywhere else. Basically, it's west side, east side. Rockies does this for you. Okay, so without the Rockies, Bozeman would be like Seattle in winter. 38 degrees Fahrenheit, 3 inches of rain for a month, no snow. Put away those boards. Sacramento in summer, that's what it would be like. 75 degrees, annual, a daily average temperature with a 10-foot inch of rain. What's that? What? Pretty cool, huh? Okay. Now let's talk about variability. First we'll talk about variability in temperature, then variability in precipitation, and then again it'll be west of the Rockies, east of the Rockies. And then the impact of El Nino and La Nina cycles, which are called ENSO cycles, and then the recent drought in perspective, in the historical perspective. So here's a histogram of the last 113 winters. Winter, December, January, February, average temperature in Bozeman. Yeah. So zero is normal, it's a climatology. And you can see the coldest winter on record was, I don't know what year, but it was about 7 degrees Celsius below normal, which is really phenomenal. Right? Things like the winter average temperature averaged something like 4 degrees Fahrenheit for winter. Right? Or not about for December. Sorry. And you can see that there's a lot of variability here, like a typical warm winter might be a degree and a half warmer than normal, and a typical cold winter might be a degree and a half colder than normal. If you do the same thing for the other seasons, you find that, yep, there's variability in spring too, there's variability in fall, and there's variability in summer, less variability in summer than there is in the other seasons. And for this X year is this year, right? So this year is warmer than normal. Okay, warmer than normal by about a degree or so. Okay, now, so the typical of most places in the West, this is very typical. Variability is greatest in winter and fall in temperature. El Nino contributes to winter variability. In summer, as far as we can tell, the variability is completely random and stochastic. In winter, it's also random, but there's an El Nino component to it, and El Nino is random. Right? But it's a phenomenon we understand. And we'll come back to that in a second. Okay, here's the time series from 1900 to I think last month, if I remember right. Of temperature for each of these lines is for a season. And this is a lot of variability. That's the histograms we just saw. But if you average over the whole year, like a 10-year running average is the black dotted line, you can see here's temperature. What do you see? Going up, right? It goes up about 1.2 degrees over the last century in Bozeman. Okay, so this is just instrumental data. Warming trend over the 20th century is about 1.2 degrees Celsius. Okay, that's actually pretty typical. So this is the trend of this is the change in temperature over a 100-year period, the same period pretty much, for everywhere else in the globe, and red is a degree here. So you can see it's kind of typical, especially at northern hemisphere land areas. Ocean areas don't warm quite as fast as our climate is warming, but there's pretty much global warming, except for this spot here. We know why that spot doesn't warm. Okay, it's another story. It's not interesting, but it was. Okay, and the biggest warming is up here in like the mid-latitude of the hemispheres and in the Arctic, right? This is expected. If you increase carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, this is exactly what you expect. Now, variability in the annual average precipitation. So now we're going to get at like what controls drought. So what's plotted here is a measure of the kind of typical year-to-year variability in precipitation divided by the average precipitation for a year over the whole climatology. And so you can see the southwest U.S. here is a really volatile place. The difference between rainfall from one year to the next can be 50% of the normal average. And that's true everywhere in the west. You know, it's not 50%, but here in Bozeman, it's more like 25%. So an unusually, say, dry year might be 25% of rainfall below normal. And that's true mostly in the west, and as you go to the east, there's less and less variability. It's more steady in terms of the annual rainfall contribution. Okay. I'm not even going to describe this. Let's just say that if you want to say what controls the variability in the annual average temperature, it turns out in the western, you know, west of the Rockies Ridge, it's all about winter. East of the Rockies Ridge, it's all about summer. That's not a surprise, right? Because in the west of the Rockies, you find that most of the rainfall falls in winter. So most of the variability in the annual average rainfall is winter. East of the Rockies, most of the variability in the annual rainfall is due to variability in summer rainfall. Okay. So impact of El Nino in La Nina cycles. El Nino Southern Oscillation, that's what ENSO stands for. That's when you call up, if you're a climate scientist, but everyone else knows this is El Nino, and the other side of El Nino is La Nina, but it's part of the same phenomenon. Okay. It's like if you're on a swing, and you're swinging back and forth, you go out here, you El Nino, and over here, you La Nina. It's the same phenomenon, it's just the two ends of it. Right? Okay, so due to tightly coupled interactions between the atmosphere and the ocean and tropical Pacific, if you threw away the rest of the world, you just left the tropical atmosphere and the ocean to interact with each other, you would still have El Ninos. If you don't let the atmosphere and the ocean interact with each other in the tropical Pacific, you don't have El Ninos and La Ninas, right? So it's about the coupling. And I'll show you some data that shows that really clearly. El Nino is the warm phase of this ENSO phenomenon. So when the tropical Pacific Ocean is warmer than usual, rainfall, which usually is in the western Pacific, moves into the central Pacific. So you have a lot of rainfall in the central Pacific for a period of about 9 months. And then La Nina is the opposite. It's where the Pacific, especially the eastern Pacific, gets colder than normal. And in the rainfall, the convection moves all the way to the west. Okay. El Ninos occur every 3 to 7 years and last for about a year. And El Nino is usually followed by 1 year of La Nina conditions. And then sort of nothing happens. The system's kind of bouncing around in it, and then another one comes up. Irregularly, but it comes up. And so it causes global scale climate anomalies. Okay, so El Nino and La Nina give you changes in climate, not just in the tropical Pacific, but throughout all of the Western Hemisphere. Okay. And actually over Africa. It also affects the global average surface temperature. When you have an El Nino, the global average surface temperature goes up by about 0.15 degrees Celsius. Right? So this year is probably going to be the warmest year ever recorded in history. Right? Some of that is because it happens to be an El Nino year. Not just any El Nino, this is one of the biggest El Ninos in recorded history. And I'll show you that data. Predictable, El Nino is predictable 9 months in advance. And it's incredibly important because a lot of developing countries depend on agriculture for income, for food, and the agriculture is driven by rain-fed precipitation, and El Nino actually has a massive effect on tropical precipitation. I'm not going to go into any of that. That's the idea. So it's the dominant pattern of climate variability on year-to-year time scales. It's the biggest thing in the zoo of animals, of climate animals. And here's the cartoon. So this is the normal situation. This is South America and North America. This is Australia over here. This is a little bit of, what's the first one you got to? New Guinea? Right, thanks. Never been there, but I'd like to. And this is like, the color here is the temperature of the water. So this is the warmest water around here in the Western Pacific normally. The trades blow this way across the Pacific, and the heaviest rainfall in the atmosphere is out here over the warmest water. Don't worry about this. Okay. When El Nino happens, what happens, and I'm not going to tell you why, but if you want to know why, you can talk to me some papers. And it's entirely unreadable, but I'll send them to you. The warm water extends all the way into the Central Pacific and even into the Eastern Pacific, and the convection here, the rainfall, moves into the Central Pacific. Okay. There's large hail changes in winds, precipitation, sea surface temperature, ocean currents, upwelling. For example, in El Nino year, sea level over Indonesia drops a meter. Sea level off the west coast of the United States goes up about half a meter. Okay. And there's big changes in ocean currents, etc. Okay. So, we have time. I want to make sure I comment. Let's keep going. El Nino, a good index of the state of El Nino is the sea surface temperature average in this box here. This box is actually bigger than the United States, but don't worry about that. So it's average. You just average the sea surface temperature there, and you just create a record of it, and you correlate it with air temperature everywhere else on the planet. And that's what's shown here, is the correlation with sea surface temperature right there. You find out that when it's warm here in the ocean, it's warm in the atmosphere. Man, that's obvious. But it's also warm all the way up through here, right? And these correlations are on the order of 0.5, so you explain about 0.5 squared, which is 25% of the variance in winter weather. It's actually in this part of the world where we live, is due to El Nino. 25% of the variability you see in winter temperature here is due to El Nino. Okay. And it's cold here where nobody lives, and it's cold in through here in the southern tier of the United States. If you look at a correlation of this index of El Nino with precipitation, you find out when it's warm here, it's raining more here. That's the reds and yellows. And the purples means it's raining less. And these correlations are minus one. So if you know what a correlation is, it means that if you know El Nino and you live in this part of the world, you know everything you need to know about what the rainfall is going to be. Everything controls everything. Not so much true for us over here. These correlations are more like 0.5 or so, 0.5 in Florida. So, but correlation is a little bit deceiving. It turns out that in the southwest U.S., there's a stronger relationship. I'll show you a picture in a second. If you look at the sea level pressure anomalies that go with this pattern, they're global. So when you have more rainfall here, you have a low pressure over here, and you have a high pressure over here, and a low pressure over here. So you have circulation anomalies in the atmosphere that expand the whole, at least half of the globe. And the way to think of this is, when you have rainfall in the atmosphere, you're taking water vapor and you condense it. Does anyone know what happens when you condense water vapor? It rains. What happens to energy? Think of the energy, think of the heat. It's released, right? It's released through the atmosphere. If you heat the atmosphere expands. So it's just like if you go into a lake, let's have your lake run here somewhere, and you're dropping stones in this lake, right? Waves go out, right? When you heat in the atmosphere, you're expanding the atmosphere, and it's just sending waves that go out, right? Now, normally the waves go out from here, but during El Nino, they go out from here. And they're going out, and so now they're going on a different path to a different place. So those paths actually go along pretty much great circle routes all the way across North America, and all the way down to South America in Antarctica. Right? So we understand that that's actually science that came out of the 1970s. Okay? So you have these global anomalies. And to see how tightly coupled the atmosphere and the ocean is, I'm just going to show you a time series now of sea surface temperature there, a measure of El Nino, and a measure of this atmosphere circulation pattern. Okay? And this is what it looks like. So what do you know about those two time series? Right? They're almost perfectly correlated. If you know one, you know the other. It just tells you that the ocean and the atmosphere in the tropical Pacific are really tightly coupled. Okay. It's very unusual. This is the only place in the world where this is true, by the way. Okay. And so effects, El Nino, La Nina, affects the global climate through atmosphere and oceanic teleconnections. There's large-scale movements of water along the west coast of the Americas. So you can see the signal all the way in the ocean, all the way to Alaska, and all the way to the southern trip of Chile. Over North America, the most important thing is during El Nino, the storm track, which usually kind of goes up here and makes my life miserable, actually more tends to extend across the southern, southeast, U.S. So the reason why it's colder here in southeast U.S. is because it's stormier. There's more clouds, and it's more rainfall down here. And it's warmer up in here because the storms that usually kind of track up in here bring us clouds and snow and everything don't bring us clouds and snow so much. Okay, that's for North America. Then there's these patterns for all over the world. It's dry here in El Nino. It's wet and warm here. It's dry here. I don't know what this red thing is. That's warm here. It's dry here. It's wet here. Okay, it's an old plot, but these are basically true. That's the conditions as of a month ago. I should have put today's picture in there because it came out. No, it's coming out tomorrow, sorry. It's almost 3 degrees warmer than normal in the central Pacific, central eastern Pacific. Now, to put that in perspective, here's the time series of El Nino and La Nina events. And if you cross this red line going up, you're in an El Nino condition. And if you cross this line going down, you're in a La Nina condition. 1980, here's a big one, 1982, 1983. Here's the next biggest one in history, which is 97, 98. And here we are today. So this is the third, at least the third, and maybe, you know, it's still growing, biggest El Nino in the instrumental record. Okay, what's that mean for us? Well, here's the forecast for January, February, and March. Okay, get up those boards, okay? No, you can't run that. So this is the likelihood the temperature is going to be above normal or below normal. Red means it's going to be above normal. If you live where I live, even if you can read this is 50%. So this is even chance. So this is just says I'm not going to be affected by El Nino. But if you live where I live, this thing is 75%. So the odds are really good. It's going to be a warm winter in Seattle, all through Washington State, northern Idaho. It's going to be, odds are 70%. It's going to be below normal here. And here's the precipitation. This is probably one you guys care about. This is 70% below normal for Bozeman, right? Bozeman, I guess, a little bit, maybe it's only 65%, but below normal. And this is statistics, right? It's no guarantee. It could be the wet, it could be the snowiest winter ever, right? It's not perfect, we've heard it. It's not 100%, right? But odds are pretty high it's going to be below normal. And if you live in Southern California, this is 80%. The odds are really high it's going to be a really wet winter in Southern California, meaning Los Angeles, San Diego, all the way up to, you know, kind of roughly San Francisco. Okay. All right. Now, there's something else called the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. And this is the warm phase of that. It's warm in the tropical Pacific as the U.S. It's cold up here. It's warm up here. Does this pattern look familiar? Yeah? And this is the cold phase. It's cold here, it's warm here, okay? And this is a time series of 1900 to 2010. It was in the kind of warm phase here for the first 40 years or so with a little dip here in the cold phase. And then from 1940 to 1985 it was in the cold phase, and then from 1980 to about 1995 it was in the warm phase, then it's been kind of in the cold phase. Okay? And it's very very likely that all the science points to this as just being the debris of El Nino. Basically, if I have two El Nino events one decade and three the next decade, and I take the average of those two decades and I subtract them from each other, I get one El Nino divided by 10 years. Right? That's all. That's probably all that's really going on. Here's the El Nino pattern. Here's the La Nina pattern. The weighting of tropical versus mid-latitude is different, but that's exactly what we expect if it's just debris events. So I'm not going to get into this, but the global impacts on temperature and precipitation are very similar to El Nino events. That is, El Nino events are like the warm phase of PDO, La Nina events are like the cold phase of PDO. Predictability is the same as JISAO, maybe up to 1 year if you're desperate. Okay. All right, the recent drought perspective. This is a map from last month of the drought severity index. This is called PDSI. It's a very popular measure of soil moisture deficit or excess. Zero being normal, minus four being extreme drought, minus 3 to 4 being severe drought, and this is to mean extremely moist. And you can see all through this region, there's purples here, which is extreme drought. And so as of September here, a lot of Southern California, Nevada, parts of Washington, Oregon, were in extreme drought, very far west of Montana. This is observations, okay? Let's look at this period, this place in here, and I'm just gonna focus on it and say, well, how does this compare to what's happening in history? All right, so we have instrumental data for temperature and other things that go back about to 1900. So here's 1900 to present, and this is the annual precipitation, and the black line here is the average precipitation for that area in Southern California. And you can see for the last few years or so, we've been quite a bit below normal in terms of precipitation in Southern California. In fact, there's only been really 2 years that we're above normal in this whole 10-year period. As far as we can tell, this is random natural variability. And it includes the impacts of El Nino and La Nina cycles and PDOs, but it's just natural variability. Like, there's no indication in this record or in any of our model results that this is climate change. Okay. Climate change may have a big impact on Southern California rainfall. If it does, it'll probably be through El Nino cycles, but we actually can't answer that question right now with the current models that we're using. Okay. Recent 1 year or even 3 year average is low, but it's not unprecedented in the record. So how do we know that? We have observations. What's unusual about the last 3 or 4 or 10 years of the drought is actually unprecedented. The rainfall is enough. Right? What's unusual is if you look at temperature in Southern California, this is what you see in that shaded area. So 1900 to 20 to I think this last month. What do you see there? Increases, right? It's like Bozeman. It's like every place else in the world. Temperature is going up. So what's unusual about this last period is when you have two things happen at the same time. Concurrent. Thanks, great. It's not the first time you say it in my life, Joby. Less rainfall and high temperatures. That's devastating if you're dirt, if your soil. There's like two stresses on you. So here's another measure of drought, it's a different measure, and zero means normal, blue means it's wetter than normal, and red means it's positive. And you can see this thing is tanking, right? It's getting more and more drought-like. And you have these extended periods here where it's very, very severe. Okay, so how do we put that into perspective? It's a pretty short record. As far as we can tell, this is random variability precipitation, and temperature is creeping up, right? So people have done a lot of work to reconstruct from what we call proxy data, because we don't have people measuring precipitation in Los Angeles in 1293 AD, right? So we've done, not me, the community has done a lot of work at reconstructing both precipitation and measures of drought, that is this PDSI index, a measure of the soil moisture. This is a plot that shows the precipitation anomaly for every year for the last 800 years, 700 years. Each dot is a year. Zero is normal precipitation, -3 is way less than normal, and this is standardized, so I'll talk about that in a second. And this is the measure of the drought, so zero is normal, this is extremely moist, this is extremely extreme drought. Here's 2014. 2014, in the last 800 years, is the most severe drought in record. It is not the most extreme precipitation. Look at this. Right? If I just draw this line here, there's a lot of years here we had precipitation that was just as low or lower than the last, than 2014. So the 2014 drought, that is the stress on soil, reduction of soil moisture, is the most severe on record since 800 AD, it turns out. This is 4 days back. Precipitation deficit is less severe. Every 30 years, we get a deficit like we had this last year. So what's unusual is this combination of pretty low precipitation every 30 years, but record high temperatures. Right? And that combination is the reason why there's an unprecedented drought right now in Southern California. Is that clear, everyone?
It is.
Okay, the three-year drought is unprecedented, but similar three-year precipitation has occurred every 180 years, it turns out. Okay. Let's go deeper time. Now I do need to know what time it is, because I really, really need to get to the future.
6:38.
Okay. You have nothing to do after 7 months? Okay. No, let's first take a look at the past 1,000 years, then we'll take a look at mid-Holocene, 6,000 years ago, when there was big changes in the way the Earth orbited the Sun. And then we'll take a quick glance at the last glacial period, when there was a 3-kilometer ice sheet over Canada, sneaking down to the border. Close the border. Okay. Here's a reconstruction of the drought, what the drought conditions are. Extremely moist, extremely drought, streamed up here. In Bozeman, actually, from this thing called the North American Drought House. And here we are at the end with it, a -2, which is pretty low, right? But if I look at some like extreme, like, well, that's pretty low. The red is just a running mean through this. That's pretty low. That's a pretty low period. You know, for 10 years, it's pretty low. That's pretty low. You know, in that sense, it's low, but you wouldn't say, like, it's a record. And this is another thing that's very useful. It's the same red record down here, and it's also plotted is the same reconstructions of drought in the central Sierra. Are they the same thing? There's some similarities, right? The correlation turns out to be 0.52. So they share about 25% of common variance. The lesson here is, when there's drought in one place in the U.S., it doesn't guarantee you there's drought in another place. In general, because El Niño has an impact on a pretty large scale of all of southwest U.S., you expect coherence in drought cycles there, but you don't necessarily think that what's going on in the southwest U.S. should be linked to what's going on in Boston. Okay. Here's another example. Here's the Colorado River flow reconstructed from, I can't remember what, how you do it. I think it's probably trees, I think, tree rings. This is the normal, 100% being normal. And it's normal for basically the last century. Here's the lowest the dark black line here is the instrumental record. This is the lowest ever recorded, which is 13% below normal. But if you go back in time, boom, there's another one, right? What's unusual, what's interesting about this is water in the Colorado River watershed was divvied up due to the observation space there. Oops. Alright, so extreme low flows occur every few hundred years. It's not like it's never been seen before. Every few hundred years we see this in the last 1,000 years. Natural variability. There's no indication that this is global warming. What's unusual at the very end of this, again, is a combination of less precipitation and really high temperatures. Okay, now, mid-Holocene, 6,000 years ago. The Earth, the way the Earth was orbiting the Sun is slightly different. Just take my word for it. insane Eastern European mathematician spent 3 years doing this calculation called Milankovitch. And actually we understand now based on his calculations that the glacial cycles that we've seen in the last 3 million years are entirely due to the way the Earth changes its orbit around the Sun. That's all you need to know. So, 6,000 years ago, it turned out that in summer, Northern Hemisphere summer, we were slightly closer to the Sun, which means we get more energy. So in summer in the Northern Hemisphere, like there's Bozeman, you get about 1.5 degrees Celsius warmer than you do today. And in winter, you get about 0.5 degree colder than you do today. Okay. So going back from 1,000 years, that's what we get. The annual mean is basically zero. There's no change in the annual mean temperature. Now let's go back 23,000 years ago. This is a time period when there was 3.5 to 4 kilometers of ice sitting over northern Canada. So you're higher up in the atmosphere because if you're on the surface, you're sitting on the ice sheet, right? So you're colder. Not just because there's ice underneath you, but because you're higher up in the atmosphere. But a lot of the globe was colder. And purple here is now minus 35 degrees Celsius, right? These are really big changes. If you live in Bozeman, it's a minus 10. It's 10 degrees Celsius colder than it was, than it is today. And light. Okay, and that was pretty much the answer for the last, well, from 2.7 million years ago to 10,000 years ago. And then we had this kind of little extra warmth in the middle Holocene. Then we've had this kind of last 1,000 years of just bumping up and down. And then the last 150 years, we're warming like crazy. All right. So, where are we going? It depends on how much carbon dioxide you emit. How much climate will respond to that increase in carbon dioxide? And it's not just carbon dioxide. We use that as a placeholder for other greenhouse gas changes that are changing. So carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas that traps energy in the climate system. So does methane, which has increased by a factor of 3 since humans have been really active doing agriculture. So is nitrous oxide, which is a greenhouse gas. Right? So the question is, where are we going? Depends on how much CO2 we put in the atmosphere and other greenhouse gases, but mainly CO2. How will the climate respond to those changes? And I'm going to show you results from 2030 and from 2100, so for the end of this century. And what will the impacts be? And there's a lot that can be done here, and I'm sure there's actually people who know more about this than me in terms of the impacts on Montana, so I'm only going to do two slides on that. All the results here are going to be taken from the last two intergovernmental reports on climate change called IPCC, AR4-2007, AR5-2003, which probably means nothing to most people. Okay. How much carbon dioxide should be released into the atmosphere? Depends on how much population grows. When population grows, what choice of energy do they use to do their business and do their agriculture or everything? Depends on things like what the regulations are going to be for what energy you use. It depends on if the governance is going to be global or regional. You can imagine the possibilities, right? Okay. And lots of people get together to come up with all sorts of scenarios based on, you know, what will population be? Will it be 9 billion? Will it be 12 billion? Will it be, you know, will the people use fossil fuels? Will they use renewables, etc.? But you can actually come up with a really conservative estimate and just say, okay, I got at least probably that out this much. Let's assume the global population increases from 7 billion, which I think is already at 7.2, to 9.5 billion. We're going to add another 2.5 billion people to the planet, almost another third. The poor people develop, right? And almost all these 2.5 billion are going to be added to developing countries, and they're going to be poor, and you just hope that they develop, right? And all economic data shows that when you develop, you use more energy. Anyone worry about that? I can show you data, but it's kind of big common sense. When you develop, you use more energy. And let's say that even though you're adding another third of the people to the planet, and you hope that they all develop and they live the same lifestyle that we all live in this world, let's say that the current emissions of carbon dioxide stay the same. What are the odds that that's going to be true? What are the odds you think this is going to be overestimated? Yeah, it's going to be a lower bound, right? Of what can happen. All right, here we go. Right now, if I grab 400 molecules of that atmosphere outside of this room, in this room, it's going to be way higher, as well as breathing carbon dioxide. If I grab a million molecules outside of this room, 400 of them will be carbon dioxide molecules. That's what the concentration is today. If I had done this 150 years ago, the answer would have been 280. Right? It's gone up almost a third since I was born, which was before they were making measurements of carbon dioxide. But we know from the experts. What else am I going to say here? So it's 400 molecules per million. That's parts per million, we call ppm. Remember that, 400 today. We are putting in the atmosphere conservatively, I'm just making numbers easy to work with here. We're putting in enough carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, of which half is about going into the atmosphere, and half of it's going into the ocean and land together. So half of it's staying in the atmosphere. We are increasing it 2 parts per million each year. right now. So if we don't change emissions and we add a certain people and they all develop, and we do 2 units per year for each year for the next 85 years to the end of the century, how much additional do we have? 170. How much did we start with? 400, right? So that's 570. So that's a pretty conservative estimate, which is over 2 times what we had before the Industrial Revolution started. Okay, so now we can go to the demographers and the economists and the policymakers, and they come up with all sorts of scenarios. Here we are today at 400, 2015, and here's these different scenarios. Depending on what you assume about fossil fuel use, governance, renewables, etc. But we just did the calculation that 570 is probably is about as good as you could hope for. So I'm going to call that utopia. And then A2 is actually business as usual. It's assuming that you go to the renewables, but at kind of uneven rates for different countries. It's assuming things like the population peaks in about 20 years or so and starts declining. And you get to more like close to 900. And there's plenty of coal in the ground in the eastern side of this state, I think it is, that you can actually go like 4 times higher than this if you want. Okay. Right. Good. So you already know that we're committed, right? I mean, we're like at least utopia, probably far beyond utopia, unless something really serious happens. You know, the plague kills a third of the population of the world, something like that. Or there's some miraculous form of new cheap energy that's renewable. Right? It's not impossible. I actually think that we don't have to go here. I really don't. But the way we're going, we're going to go way beyond 570. So, for reference, if you want to reduce emissions to the point where nature is taking this out of the atmosphere as fast as you're putting it in, right? We have not only have to just level off. So if you level off emissions, it still means you're putting it in the atmosphere, right? It's still accumulating. You have to get down to 100 kilograms per person per year emissions, and the U.S. average is 5,500. Okay. So that means that's why this problem. That is why this is a hard problem. Right? This is not a climate problem. It's hard. It's, if you believe climate change is a problem, what's a problem here is in the U.S., basically, we have to run our economy on about 2% of our present-day fossil fuel emissions. Right? There's ways you can do it, right? But it is nothing less than saying that you're going to run the world on an entirely different energy source. Or when you burn that coal and oil, it creates CO2, you're going to take it out of the atmosphere. Humans are going to take it out, which is right now is prohibitively expensive. The last time we were at 570 ppm, it was probably the Eocene, which was about 35 million years ago. It's when you had alligators at the North Pole. Okay, and you had palm trees in Wyoming. Wyoming was a little bit farther north. Yeah, palm trees. Okay, so IPCC 8 years ago came out with a report. 2 years ago came out with a report. Not much has changed. In fact, not much has changed since the original calculation, which was done in 1896, over 120 years ago. Okay? The business as usual scenario of emissions of how much CO2 is going to, used to be called A2, now it's called RCP 8.5. It gives you an effective amount of CO2 if you take all the greenhouse gases, and you say, let's say it's the equivalent of the increase in CO2, it would put you at about 930 parts per million. And the global average temperature increase over the next 90 years would be 3.4 degrees C. The increase over the last century was 0.85. So this is a fourfold, almost fivefold increase in temperature of what we've seen in the last 100 years. If you believe in utopia, this can be called B1, that's called RCP 4.5. It has 530 parts per million CO2, and it increased the global average temperature by 1.8, or about twice as much as we saw in the last century. That's utopia. Split the difference. This used to be called A1B, it's not called RCP 6.0, 670 ppm, 2.2 degrees C. It turns out the pattern of temperature change you see is the same for each one of these scenarios. And it's the same for every climate model. It's just that the amplitude of it just depends on the sensitivity of that climate model. So I'm going to show you results from the split the difference. as I'm going to show you today. If you're a real optimist, you can multiply everything I show you, not for 2030, but I can multiply everything I show you for the end of the century by 0.7, and you'll have the answer. But if you are, I don't know, pessimist, business as usual, multiply everything I show you by 1.5. So if you swap this vocabulary, then the results and conclusions of the truths and the two things are the same. Three reports are the same. Nothing's really new. AR5, the last report, has one more emission scenario to illustrate that it's almost certain that global average temperature will increase by more than 2 degrees Celsius in this century. It's kind of inescapable. Otherwise, there's nothing new in AR5 that is of any consequence to the public or for policymakers. So you can take that, whatever it is, 3,000-page report. I wouldn't say burn it, because there goes the CO2, right? Put some more plastic on it and put it in your basement. Okay. Sequester that CO2. Okay. Global average surface change. This is what's actually observed is the black line here from the last century. And the gray here is what climate models do if you give it the observed concentrations of carbon dioxide through the 20th century and methane and everything else. This is 0.85 degrees. Each one of these lines is for a different emission scenario going forwards. That's utopia. Utopia says by the end of the century I'll be 1.6 degrees above today's temperature. That's business as usual, 3.4 degrees, and that's split the difference. And what's also shown here, the green, the solid line here is the average across all the climate models, right? All the climate models have about 30 of them. And this is an old picture, but we have about 30 now we're using. This is the average, and the light green shading here is the kind of range of answers you get from different climate models. So there's two sorts of uncertainty here. One is, we don't know how much we're going to emit, and two, we actually don't know exactly what the answer's going to be. Even if you give every climate model the exact same emissions, they give you different answers. But, you know, that's a really cold climate model, and that's a really warm climate model. Even the really cold climate models tell you it's going to be a really hot world compared to the current world. Okay. 30-year projections. Now, this actually turns out to be not dependent on the emission scenario. We've already kind of bought into this. No matter which emission scenario you talk about, this is the answer. Now, it still means that each climate model will give you a different answer. Right? And I'm going to show you the kind of spread you get in the climate model. Here's a summary of what we expect. Everywhere, an average temperature rise of 1 and 1.5 degrees. This is for the western US, right? This is for you guys. This is for me in Seattle, or Southern California. Expect the average temperature to increase by 1 to 1.5 degrees. Right? And this is the next 30 years, right? That's a bigger number than the last 100 years, right? Day-to-day and month-to-month variability about the new mean, this could be a new mean, will not change very much over the next 35 years. And as a result, there will be more record high temperatures and less record low temperatures. Does that make sense to everyone? You're just shifting the mean. You have the same wobbling around. But that means you're more likely to hit a record high temperature and you're less likely to hit a record low temperature. And that's what you see in the United States already over the last 50 years. We've broke twice as many high temperature records as we've broke the low temperature. The likelihood of extreme precipitation events will increase everywhere, but the season average precipitation will not change significantly. The projected 30-year climate changes are relatively insensitive to a wide range of emission scenarios. That's for the next 30 years. Okay, here's a picture of what you expect for summer and winter. And this is the temperature change. This is the temperature change, say, today, 2035 minus today, so over the next 35 years. I'll still be alive, hopefully. Maybe not. Okay. In summer, we get a warming of like a degree or a degree and a half over the United States. You know, pretty much the whole planet warms. Land warms more than ocean. In the wintertime, still true, land warms more than ocean. And you get this very large winter warming here, and that's simply because sea ice melts and replaces sea ice with ocean, which is warm, right? So you get more warming in winter than summer. Okay. Now, and the stippling means that the models all agree on the difference, and the difference between models is actually small compared to the natural variability. So this is like, certainly you'll detect this, okay? So this is the winter temperature change, and I've just focused here on the western US. Everyone got this picture? Here's Baja, west coast US, Bozeman must be up there around here somewhere, right? Here's the same, here's another picture, here's another picture. This is 2035 forecast, not forecast, but a projection. And this is the median. You take all the climate models and say, what's the climate model that's actually in the middle of the distribution? And the answer is here in the western US, and I'm trying to put up these numbers for Bozeman, you're about 1.25 degrees Celsius above where we are at today, right?
Translate that into Fahrenheit?
About two. 2 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay? Thanks. Yeah, I struggled with whether I should put everything in Fahrenheit. I should have. But then I ran out of time. Okay. If you take a model that's actually kind of wimpy, that you give it to CO2 and it says, I don't want to do too much, you know? It doesn't say that, but it just says it has different strengths and feedbacks. So a model that actually doesn't respond much to CO2 would actually only warm it by 0.75 or about a degree and a half Fahrenheit above normal. And a model that's pretty sensitive would warm it by 1.5 degrees Celsius or about 3 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay? Now, do the same thing. I'm going to show you a slice for 2065, right? So now it's 60 years down the road. So the little one will still be around for the next two. Here we go, 2065. Middle of the road, 2.25 degrees above normal. Above normal, that's compared to today, 2.75 degrees above normal. So now we're talking about in excess of 5 degrees Fahrenheit above today's temperature. Average over all winter long. And if the models that are a little bit more sensitive to CO2 are the right answer, and we just don't know which one of these is the right answer, then the answer is it'll be close to 8 degrees Fahrenheit above today's temperature in winter. And if the models that are on the cold side are right, it'll only be 4 degrees Fahrenheit, 2 degrees Celsius above today's temperature. No matter how you slice it, it's way warmer than it's been for a very long time. We'll put that in perspective in a second. This is using a low emission scenario. So if you want a high emission scenario, you basically double everything on this page when you get to 2100. Right? Those are really different worlds. Okay, summertime, here's the answer. Not quite as much warming. So we get 1.25 is the typical warming for the western US, 0.5 for the wimpy climate model, wimpier climate models, and 1.5 for the smart ones. If you go to 2065, you get the same picture. It's not, the amount of warm you get as a function of season over the US or over Europe is kind of seasonally independent. It's about the same answer. And again, if the more realistic emission scenario is business as usual instead of like split the difference, you're talking about doubling these numbers. Okay, at 2100. These numbers are pretty, they're going to be pretty insensitive what happens over the next 30 years. Because the emission scenario is going to differ very much over that period, okay. So what's a global average temperature change look like? Well, here's the same kind of plot, global average temperature change. 1950, 2000, 2050, 2100. The red line here is for business as usual scenario, which now in the IPCC report takes it 4 degrees above normal, not 2, 3.4, so it's gone up a little bit. And this is not utopia, this is a scenario where you actually are taking a lot of carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. So there's actually net negative emissions, you know, by basically the last half of the century. This is a split the difference picture of the world average temperature change in 2090, basically, compared to today, or at the end of the century compared to today. And basically, you're looking at 3 degrees Celsius above normal in the United States. You're looking at, it depends on what happens to sea ice, but 5 to 6 degrees above normal annual average temperature. And pretty much the whole world looks like that. Now, the only way you can actually do this is by somehow trapping the energy that's in the Earth system and the whole Earth is going to warm up. It's not like the wind is blowing from the north and so it's colder, or the wind is blowing from the south. Because if I blow the wind from the south, it warms up in this region. Somewhere the wind's got to be blowing the other way, right? And it's just rearranging temperature. This is not rearranging temperature. This is increasing CO2, which increases water vapor, which increases the greenhouse effect, which makes the whole planet warmer. was first understood by Joseph Fourier in 1850. So you double that picture for more realistic emission science. Okay. For reference, that's the picture you get. Remember we talked about the middle Holocene 6,000 years ago when the Earth altered the sun difference? That's the global average temperature change 6,000 years ago on the same scale as this. It's basically zero. If you did the same thing for 10,000 years ago, you get the same answer. If you did the same thing for 23,000 years ago, you would get a really cold answer because you have ice sheets around. And that's due to the way the Earth orbits the sun, not changes in greenhouse gases. Okay? How unusual is this? This is a plot, a little old now, but it's a measure of the likelihood that the summer temperature, actually that's growing season average temperature. And then we did somebody did this place because we were talking about agriculture. So the northern hemisphere is summer, southern hemisphere is summer. We just put them on the same page. It's the likelihood that the summer average temperature will exceed the highest temperature ever recorded at your place in space. In red basically means excess of 90%. So pretty much really large swaths of the world, everywhere between 35 north and say 40 degrees north and 35 degrees south or so, you'll have the highest temperatures ever recorded. Even for the, let's put the difference emission scenario, even taking the wimpiest climate model we have, that emission scenario, the odds of surpassing the highest temperature ever recorded are basically 100%. Okay. You guys got quiet. Yeah, I've lost you, or it's as depressing as most people tell you. God, aren't you depressed? And actually, well, that's okay. Okay, so most of the tropics and subtropics, the seasonal average temperature will very likely exceed the warmest temperature. Very likely is science talk for meaning the odds are greater than 90%, which is a good bet. So what does it mean for the projections of the Western U.S.? Temperatures will increase by 1 to 2 degrees Celsius, or 2 to 4 by Fahrenheit, by 2035. By 2100, depending on the emission scenario and the strength put in the climate model you use, the temperature increases will be 4 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit, average over all the season. These will be modulated by El Niño, PDO, and other random variability, just like they are today. And it's possible that the El Niño impacts La Niña might change, but we can't answer that question right now. We're working on it, but it's going to be another 10 years probably. Precipitation is less certain. What we do know is far north, there's going to be more water vapor in the air. And just if you have the same storm, you're going to have more precipitation. So in the far north, like Canada and Antarctica and Greenland, there's going to be more precipitation happening. But north, south of the border, the Canadian border, say, we actually can't say very much. So the assumption should be just that you have the same amount of precipitation. You expect the soil to dry, though, right? Because with the same amount of precipitation and warming, it means you have more evaporation. There's a little caveat here, which is really exciting, which is one of the reasons why I like to come here, because there's so many ecologists who understand ecology more than I do. Which isn't hard, actually, but these guys are really good. Snow line will increase in elevation. If you just warm everything up, the elevation you go to where precipitation changes from snow to rain will increase, right? And we kind of have a good handle on this. So it only depends really on the temperature change that you have. You expect an increase in the snow line elevation to be between somewhere up in 150 to 300 meters by 2035. So. That's going to have huge impacts here. I don't know what they are, but I think there's probably a lot of people in this community that are working on here at MSU. Okay. By 2100, the snow line should increase by 300 to 850 meters. 850 meters is about 2,800 feet. Right? These are really big changes in snow lines, you know, where you transition from snow to rain. And you can imagine all the consequences here. Natural ecosystems, they're going to have to adapt to pretty big changes. Invasive species. I hope I didn't say, if you want to say how far back you go to get this much warming over the next, we expect the next 100 years, you have to go through the last ice age when it was really cold, which takes you back 3 million years. And you have to go back in time, right, until you get to, you have CO2 that's 500 parts per million. And we actually don't know exactly where it was, but it was probably only over 35 million years ago. So think about that. Right? Yeah, 35 million years ago, maybe 600 ppm of CO2. Then you have 150 years ago, we had 280. And all of a sudden, we're up to 550 again in 150 years, right? Or 250 years. So the rate of increase is also about 100 to 1,000 times faster than nature can do it. And that also is kind of an interesting thing that's going to play out in terms of ecosystems response. So you have adaptation, you have invasive species, you're going to have to deal with species extinctions, increased disturbances both in fire, pest, and disease, marine acidification, right? You stuff CO2 in the atmosphere and some of it gets dissolved in the ocean, about a quarter of it. And that makes the ocean more acidic. And you perturb the very basic food chain in the ocean. And I don't think anyone knows what's going to happen as you go up the food chain in the ocean to this. Manage ecosystems. We're going to have impacts on agriculture, forestry, fisheries, and water. Changes in impacts will be much greater if you use a business as usual scenario. Okay, so now we're out of time.
10 after 7.
Okay. I could show you this picture. This is the, there's a name for this thing. What do you call it when you're looking at river coming out, water coming out of the river?
Hydrograph.
Thanks. October, it starts to snow and it starts to rain. It's the western U.S. This is actually from somewhere in Washington, Quinault. And basically the river flow increases and then it kind of stays high all through the weekend. We're getting precipitation and then it kind of comes down. And part of the come down here is that you have snow that's accumulating and it's now melting as you go into spring and summer. And it stays high here and then it comes down. And this is a projection for the Quinault by the late 20th century, it's a blue thing. So you're going to have much more larger flows in the wintertime simply because the snow line is going to be higher. So the same amount of precipitation means there's going to be places where it used to fall as snow and stay, and not as falling as rain, it's going to come off the rivers. That means there's going to be less snow left over at the end of spring. So when you look at the flows in the springtime, they're going to be much lower. Because what used to be snow sticking up there came down as rain and already went off the rivers. Okay, so let me just, big change in forestry. There's way more people here that know a lot about this. So I'm just going to show you one picture that I like. And it's just an estimate of if you just increase the global average temperature at 1°C, which turns out to be about a warming of about 1.5 degrees for this part of the world. How will the incidence of fire change? Right? And what's plotted here, this is from Jeremy Littell's et al.'s work. And each one of these like blotches here is for different echo something or other, echo plots. So a collection of the way species are interacting, I think is the way to describe this. And it says the global average temperature increases by 1 degree. If the temperature around here goes up by 1.5 degrees, you can expect about a 515% increase in forest fires. Right. Now, this is only a yardstick of saying, like, do I have to worry about this or do I not? If the answer on this paper is like 10%, you say, well, okay, it's small. It's not that this is the answer, because obviously at 515%, you're going to run out of fuel really fast. Right? It just tells you how big this problem is. And the answer is, it's pretty big. I mean, these numbers are basically a 100% increase to a fivefold increase in fire frequency for large fire burns. And I'm sure there's people in this room can complain about this figure, but I don't think anyone complained about this going to be large increases in fires. I mean, look at this year, it's a great example in west-eastern Washington, right? It was an incredibly hot summer for us, and the fires were unbelievable this year, right? Okay, so here's the summary. I said all this, so there it is. I'll just leave it up there. And I just want to say again, thank you so much for inviting me here. You're going to be upset with this. I just feel so lucky to be able to work and trying to understand the world and to be able to share it with people. And the fact that you guys all showed up here and filled this room means a lot to me. Also means a lot to me that friends of mine in the audience, there's five people that I spent a month in Tibet with, which is like one of the best experiences of my life, and I'm really so happy to be here. And thank you so much for having me.